Well, roll up for the big budget giveaway. Josh Frydenberg last night splashing billions, tackling the rising cost of living, splashing on petrol taxes and slashing it, and putting cash back into the hip pockets of middle Australia. But make no mistake, this was a budget all about winning your vote come election time. Let's discuss with Shadow Treasurer Jim Chalmers in Canberra and host of 2GB Drive Sydney, Jim Wilson here in Melbourne. Good to see you, Jimmy. Jim Chalmers, first up, did you watch nervously last night as the election slowly slipped away from you?
Oh, of course not, Carl. I think people will see through this budget like they see through the Prime Minister. They know it's an act of political desperation. They know that Scott Morrison woke up at some point in the last few weeks and realised he had to call an election soon, and so he better get the shovel out, and that's what he's done. But there's no plan beyond May in the budget. Budget should be about plans for the future as well as easing cost of living pressures. This budget doesn't really see beyond the next 6 or 7 weeks.
You must have a litany of reasons to say no to so much of what happened last night. What exactly will you stop from happening?
Oh, I think the big issue with the budget really, Carl, was that what happens after May. It's not necessarily a matter of, you know, picking apart some of this cost of living relief. I think that will go through the parliament, if not today, then tomorrow. We've said for some time, I think I said to you on Monday, you know, we'll be up for cost of living relief in the context of people's real wages falling. So people do need a bit of help. Our issue is really what's not in the budget beyond May. You know, no plan to grow the economy in a way that works for everyone, whether it's cleaner and cheaper energy or skills or childcare or the digital economy or a future made in Australia. All of our economic plans, and that's because the government's temperamentally incapable of seeing beyond May. They've got this act of political desperation. They've whacked it on the credit card, but there's nothing beyond May to give people a sense of where the economy's headed, what's the role of the government in that, and how we can do better.
Jim, seems to be going all right, the economy.
Well, it is, considering what we've come through. I mean, it's, you know, we've had 2 years in, with the pandemic, and I think you look at unemployment, obviously, is at a very, you know, with a three in front of it. So, I mean, well, it's set to be have a three in front of it. So I think, generally speaking, I mean, yeah, the deficit. I mean, we're $1 trillion in debt. So, I mean, you know, for the whoever's going to be treasurer beyond May and beyond the election, whether it's Jim Chalmers or Josh Frydenberg, I mean, they've got their work cut out as far as the debt's concerned. But what other choices did the government have as far as what we've been through than to go and have JobKeeper, JobSeeker? I mean, these are extraordinary times and extraordinary circumstances. I think the budget last night, is it enough to actually convince the Australian people to go and vote for the coalition and give them another term? Not sure about that, but I think considering all things, cutting the fuel excise had to happen. So we could save something like 22 cents a litre, which I think is a good thing.
How effective that's going to be in the long term as well?
Well, it's for 6 months. Yeah. So you're exactly right, Carl. And I think the other thing is too, let's see if the fuel companies pass it on. That's the big thing as well. So the government's saying they'll be monitoring and putting the pressure on fuel companies. But I think, generally speaking, for low, middle income, you know, the offset, the tax breaks, the offset tax breaks, I think for seniors, the one off payment.
Yeah.
You know, I think considering all things, considering the debt, I think it's the best they could do. Is it enough to convince the Australian electorate to give them another term? Not convinced.
Jim, you've been left with a beautiful present. If you win office, obviously you're going to have to put the excise back on fuel. How soon will you do that?
Well, I think no matter who wins the election, people should expect that excise goes back on September. That's what the legislation will say. I think that's one of the motivations behind what they've done, frankly. They've taken a big problem that exists before the election, they've pushed it to just the other side of the election, and no matter who wins, going to have to deal with it. I think Jim Wilson was right. You know, there's $1 trillion of debt in the budget. The question is whether we've got enough to show for that. I think not. There has been a lot of rorts and wasting taxpayer money in the budget. If there hadn't been so much wasted, we could have had more room to support people with their cost of living pressures and to invest in the future. So I think there are significant issues in the budget still. No government's actually gone to an election with a worse set of books than this one will be going to this election. It's the most wasteful government since Federation, and I think that will be an election issue.
What would you do today to ease cost of living? Because I'm not sure that anything in the budget was going to ease inflation, but what would you do to ease it today?
Oh, I think the big gap was in childcare policy. You know, if you think about the pressures on families, you know, petrol's a big part of it. but so is groceries, building materials, rent, childcare and all the rest of it. Our policies are about getting childcare bills down, big part of the story. Our policies are about getting energy policies down as well. And so, you know, we would have liked to have seen more ambition on those two policies, at least in the budget that was handed down last night. The government doesn't want to go down that path. If we're elected, we will.
So, but you're happy to spend more than the government?
Oh, no, we've said there's other areas of the budget, Carl, that you could trim back to make room for some of these investments. You know, when economists look at this budget, you know, one of the big defining features is that it doesn't have a lot of quality spending. There's that trillion in debt that Jim Wilson mentioned, and we don't have enough to show for it because the spending hasn't been responsible enough or high enough quality. And so we want to shift the emphasis in the budget.
But you're not going to reduce the debt. You're only going to add to it, right?
No, we're saying there are other parts of the budget where you could trim. You know, the government spends billions of dollars on contractors and consultants. There's an opportunity there. There are other opportunities as well to trim spending where there's been the most egregious waste. So we want to reprioritise the budget. We want to make higher quality spending a feature of the budget. It's been missing for the best part of a decade.
OK, there was a last night Parliament, an extraordinary moment with an outgoing Liberal senator absolutely unloading on the PM. Take a look at this.
In my public life, I have met ruthless people. Morrison tops the list, followed closely by Hawke. Morrison is not fit to be Prime Minister, and Hawke certainly is not fit to be a minister.
Jim Chalmers, there's something very special about friendly fire before an election, isn't there?
Well, there's a pattern here, Carl. The people who work most closely with the Prime Minister and know him the best trust him the least. Senator Fiavanti-Wells is not the first to make that point. And if you can't trust him to deal with his long-term senators in a trustworthy way, you can't trust him on wages or the budget or cost of living or all these other issues that he's now pretending to care about because he's got to all call right. an election in the next fortnight.
Everyone sees through that one, don't they?
Well, the onus is on both sides of the political aisle. If they want a safe workplace and improve the culture of the place, I've been saying about this for a long time on the program, the last couple of weeks, these very serious allegations about involving the late Kimberley Kitching. The onus is on Labor as well to say, right, it's about culture. And there's serious allegations against three of their most senior women. They're denying the bullying allegations, but at least have a proper inquiry.
Yeah.
Albo, there seems to be one rule for Albo and Labor and a different set of rules for the coalition. So let's just clean up the place, improve the culture, and that's vital.
Big day here.
Yeah.
We are out of time, but it's going to be a special evening, isn't it?
Yeah, I'm going to be here tonight, and I think it's going to be a very special evening. I think it's a celebration of an amazing life, and I knew Shane for the best part of 30 years, and his family will be here. They'll unveil the grandstand in his honour.
Yeah,
you're going to have sort of Sir Elton John. You're going to have Chris Martin from Coldplay, Ed Sheeran, you know, with special video tributes. I mean, cricket legends will be here. It's going to be a 2.5-hour service from 7 o'clock tonight here at the MCG. You can get along to the SCG as well, where they'll beam the service on the big screen. A really special moment. And that statue behind you right now.
Yeah.
It's just, there was only one Shane Warne.
They're inviting everyone to wear their World Series cricket gear in their white. So you dust them off, Jimmy.
I've dusted them off.
You
I've
too,
got the Vegemite and the cheese pizza ready to go as well, and the baked beans.
Oh, I love it.
And the Midorian lemonade.
It's my kind of diet.
Get into it, fellas.
Today's top stories.